So good afternoon all of you and welcome back to Excelsior Academy. So today we'll be doing animal cell culture techniques part 1. Okay. So what is animal culture? What is the cell culture? How it is done? Why it is done? What are its application? So everything we're going to learn about the animal tissue culture. So cell culture has become one of the major tools used in the life science today. Now why it has become major tool? Because see, now you know so many viruses are there, for example the coronavirus, which is there. Now in order to understand how it is attacking the humans, whether it is affecting the lungs, kidney, or which part of the body, so all these studies are done now using these animal tissue culture. So this is very, very big advantage of using the animal tissue culture, because now you don't have to try on humans or you don't have to try on the chimpanzees and monkeys. Now the better option is there to culture and check for the how the virus is progressing in the animal cells. So using the animal tissue culture. So this is also ruling out your ethical issues, which was initially there, like why we are using only chimpanzees and monkeys, right? So it was not ethical. So with the advancement of using the tissue culture, now it has become a major tool and it is easy and cheaper also. And plus it gives you the result earlier as compared to the chimpanzees and monkeys. Now, what do you mean by tissue culture? So tissue culture, it is the removal of cells or tissues or organs from an animal or plant and their subsequent placement into the artificial media for growth. Now, since we are going to talk about animal tissue culture over here, so we'll focus on the animal part, right? So the cells and tissues and organs will be taken from the animal portion. Now, they are finally removed and placed into the artificial media for the growth. So this artificial media is designed in such a way that it actually provides all the nutrients, minerals, salts, which is required by these cells and tissues to grow as it is provided in the in vivo condition, like how it is placed or how it is present in our system. Okay, so now these are cultured in a suitable glass or plastic culture vessels containing liquid or semi-solid media, which supplies the nutrients which is essential for the survival and growth of the culture. Now the plates will be look like this. The petri dishes will be there, small will be there. So it is called P30. Then you have got P60. Those are the bigger petri dishes and plastic one we use. Plastic and they are sterile. Okay, so there are few people who use glass also, but then the problem is with the contamination. That is, if it is washed by someone and it is not sterilized properly, so the next person who is going to use the glass will have the problem with the contamination. So mainly in the case of animal tissue culture, what we usually do is we use plastic which is sterile. Okay, so directly it is used in the culture hood by opening the packet. Now the packet entire thing is actually sterile. Now this is how it looks like. So you can see that these are called the T flask, and these are your P60, and these are your P30, and these are called 24 culture plates. 24 culture plates. Okay, and this is your 96 titer plates. If you see this over here, the media color is there. So it is because of the presence of the phenol red. Please remember all this thing. Okay. So whenever there is a change or decrease in pH, what will happen? Phenol red is acting as the indicator. So it is the indicator that the pH of the media has been changed. So usually it is at the physiological pH. Okay. That is how your cells are growing, right? At the physiological pH. Now, since these cells are growing, so there will be metabolic activities. Now, because of these metabolites will be released into the media, the pH will decrease. Now, decrease in pH means this color of the media will become orange or yellowish kind of thing. Okay. So from looking at itself, we will understand that the nutrients of the media is over and the cells have overgrown. So because of which the pH has been changed. So what will be the next step? You have to change the media. So you wash your plate and then add new media. Now under microscope, this is normal, your around 20x microscope condition. You can see the cells will look like something like this. Okay. So directly your plate is there. And directly you place it under the microscope and you can check and you can visualize the cells. So something like this it will look. Now over here the figures which I have shown here is the different types of cells are there. But this is your fluorescence image using the fluorescence microscope. Okay. Now, what you have to remember is over here is whenever we actually stain the DNA, the dye is called DAPI. Okay. I don't remember the full form of DAPI over here. Then we have to stain green in color. There is something called NXNV FITC. You can use that. And in the case of red, you have got phalloidin. Phalloidin. So that you have to remember. So please remember the color. Many colors are there. Many dyes are there. But these are the basically which is routinely used. Okay. So in the case of DNA, it is DAPI. And in the case of green, it is your NXN, Pi, FITC is there. Okay. Now, the full form of DAPI is 4,6-diamino-2-phenyl-indole. Okay. So, what is the thing? It is only binding to your DNA. And in the DNA also, only your adenine thymine rich regions. Can you remember all these things? These are the features of the DAPI. So I repeat again, it is the full form is 4,6-diamino-2-phenyl-indole and it is binding to the 80 rich regions of your DNA. And this is the wherever you see this blue color, that is your DAPI and it will only stain your nucleus. Please remember. Okay. So now growth of animal cells in the culture. So animal cells are more difficult to culture than microorganism. Now this is why, because in the case of animal cells, you have got high demands of nutrients. It's not like microorganisms just provide the glucose and it will be enough or it's sufficient for the growth. In the case of animal cells, you need to provide the growth factors also, vitamins also, and then the proper surface also so that these cells can attach and then they can grow. Now, despite all these difficulties, various types of animal cells are there, both undifferentiated and differentiated, and they can be cultured successfully. So now we all have that much advancement that you can now culture any kind of animal cells. Now, so why the cell culture is used for? So there are many reasons for that. First of all, used as a model system to study. So as I mentioned about the coronavirus, you can study the effects of the coronavirus on the cell tissues. So we can also study the effects of the drugs on the cells. The process and triggering of the aging and nutritional study. So sometimes what we do is like, suppose you want to carry out the anti-cancer drug findings, right? So whatever drugs you have, you can actually add to these tissue cultures, animal tissue cultures, and you can see whether your drug is able to kill your cancer cells or not, right? So you are going to have your uncontrolled cell also and the cancer cell also. So you need to see that the drugs are only killing your cancer cells and it is not killing the control cells. Control cells means normal cells. If your drug is killing both normal cells as well as the cancer cell, then you cannot use the drugs because once it is inside the body, the drugs can also kill your normal cells, which is not good for the individual, right? So that's why you need to study both on the control cells as well as on the cancer cells. Then next is toxicity testing. So again, whether the drugs which you have made, it is going to be toxic or not. So in order to test the toxicity, you are going to use the normal cells, the control cells. Because if you are going to take these drugs onto your body or you are going to apply, then you need to know whether it is going to have any toxic effects on the normal cells or not. Then cancer research, as I mentioned, so studying the various function of the chemicals, virus or radiations. And converting whether they are able to convert the normal cells into cancerous cells or not. So many applications are there. Now virus for the vaccine production, then genetic engineering, so production of commercial proteins, lastly production of viruses. So these vaccines which are mentioned over here, they're also produced using the animal tissue culture. Then we have got the gene therapy. So cells having functional gene can be replaced to the cells which are having non-functional gene. So actually the more it seems easy to say to carry out gene therapy, it is that much difficult also. So if you have heard the story of SCID, so SCID means severe combined immunodeficiency, right? So in this case, what happens, the person is staying inside the bubble. So the patient is there inside the bubble. When you say bubble, it means what? It is just covered with the plastic and only sterilized air is passed, because this in the people who are having SCID are immunocompromised. So they cannot even, they are very allergic to everything. Even a single bacteria can kill them. So that's why only sterilized air is provided into their chamber. So that's why we say that it is inside the bubble. Now, why this is happening? This is happening because of the deficiency of adenosine deaminase. Okay. So these are the additional information I am giving. So make sure that you go through all this thing again. Make short notes on these also. Now, how the gene therapy was designed for this? By replacing the non-functional gene with the functional gene. That is your adenosine deaminase. So this was actually given with the help of the virus. So your virus was inactivated and it was having the functional gene of the adenosine deaminase. So it was given to the SCID patient. So this SCID patient survived 2 to 4 years more, but eventually died out. Okay. So even though we say gene therapy is successful, but the lifespan is not that much has been improved. So still work is going on. Now, what is primary culture? This is important. Okay. So when you start working in the research lab, you don't have the primary culture. What you have is the secondary culture. So making primary culture is quite difficult actually. But once it is made, then it is easy to carry out all your research. Now, how it is done? The cells are surgically or enzymatically removed from the organism and it is placed in the suitable culture environment onto which it can grow. Okay. Now they have got the finite lifespan. What does it mean? It means that after 25 to 40 cycles of division, the cells will die out. They cannot further divide. So you can use till 25 to 40 cycles of the divisions. Okay. Now they contain very heterogeneous population of cells. What do you mean by heterogeneous? Anyone who can tell me what do you mean by heterogeneous?
Different
kinds of population of cells will be there. So even if I take liver cells, okay, it is called hepatocytes, right? So even if I take from one organism, what happens after repeated cell cycle divisions, what happens? The cells start differing. So in this, it means what? The surface proteins, which are present on the surface of these cells, they start differing. So within the same hepatocytes, I'll have different kinds of hepatocyte cells. Okay. Now, subculturing primary cells leads to generation of cell lines. So what does it mean? So once you have got your primary culture, now subculturing means taking small amount from this and culturing into new plates. How you do in the case of bacteria. So what will happen? This becomes one cell line, this becomes another, and this becomes the third cell line. Okay. Now they have the limited lifespan. They passage several times before they become senescent. So it means what? If you're talking about the primary culture, so you have established the primary culture and it will go further 25 to 40 cycles only. And after that, they die out. Okay. Now, lineage of cells originating from primary culture is called the cell stream. Now, this is how you actually make your primary culture. So what exactly is happening over here? So this is your tissue. You have taken small piece of tissue over here and you have added the buffer. So usually you can add the buffer or you can add the media itself in which you are going to culture the cells. Then what you have done? You are going to homogenize it. Homogenize means tissues will be broken into the cells. Respective individual cells will be there. So finally, what you're getting is the cell suspension in the media. So you're going to wash it. Now, how you're going to wash? Using 1x PBS. What is PBS? It is phosphate buffer saline. Okay, always remember. So 1x PBS. So washing means you're going to add into this centrifuge it, remove the buffer. Okay. Now, after that, you have got the cells. This is your media. So, onto the culture dish. So, what you're going to do? Place the media first and to that, start adding your cells. Then, allow to incubate. Okay. Now, how long it is needed? So at least 24 hours is needed in the case of animal cells. Whereas in the case of bacteria, one division takes only 120 minutes. So in a day, you can get so many culture. Whereas in this case, you can get at least 24 hours is needed so that the cells will adhere to the surface. Now, once it adheres to the surface, now you can actually subculture it to different culture plates. Then it is called the secondary culture. Is it clear? So this is how you make your primary culture and secondary culture. You can use it. The more I say, it looks very easy, but in reality, it doesn't work out like that. Most of the time, your primary cells die before adhering to the surface. So they die. Now, why they die, what kind of nutrient you should add, you have no idea. So it's all hit and try. So is it clear, whatever has been explained here?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Clear, ma'am.
So primary culture, so it can be any animal tissue, skin, kidney, liver, or you can take the whole embryo also. Now to prepare the tissues for culture, you need to have the trypsin also, and another protease in order to destroy the proteins in the junctions that normally interconnect the cells. So as I said, these cells are actually attached like this, right? Inside the tissue, your cells are attached like this. So we need to break the junctions of these. And these are nothing, these junctions are your tight junctions. We'll learn about these junctions later. So you have got tight junctions are there. In few cases, you see about the desmosomes are present. Some cases, you see hemidesmosomes are present. So all these need to be broken down, for which you use proteases or trypsin. Okay. So along with that homogenization, you need proteases and trypsin also in order to make your tissue into your cell suspension. Okay. Now one more thing you need to remember. So once your plate has been covered with the cells, you need to transfer it to the other cell, other petri dishes, right? This is called subculturing, and this becomes your secondary culture from your primary culture. Correct. Now to transfer it to the other culture media, it is difficult to remove these cells. So they are actually attached to the surface. Now how you're going to make them detached? Again, you're going to use trypsin. Okay. So add trypsin to the media, what will happen? Trypsin is going to cleave all the protein interactions of the cell with the surface. So your cells are actually holding the surface. So that holding, that interactions we need to break, and that is broken using trypsin. Now once it has been broken, now you can transfer it to the different culture cells. Okay. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
So how are cell cultures obtained? So there are many methods are there. So either you can use the entire organ, you can use, right? As we have seen in the last case, you can use the liver totally. So what will happen? So these cells are taken from the liver. So they are going to show the functions and the chemical experiments or whatever the reactions are carried out in the liver. Those will be shown by those cells. Okay. So they are going to have the differentiated character. So they will have all the hepatocyte features. If you take from the nerve, if you're taking from the brain, so they will have all the features of the neuronal cells, right? Now they do not grow rapidly, and it is limited to the periphery of the expanse. So what does it mean? The cell proliferation, that is, it will not divide as fast as the cancer cells or your bacteria divides. It will take time because the attachment it will take, and it is adjusting to the new environment. So many a times what happens, even if you have taken lots of amount of cells in order to start the experiment, but eventually you are having only few amount of cells left over, and it is difficult to grow. Okay. So these cannot be propagated for long periods. So if your research is including the organ culture, then every time you need to harvest the organ from the organism. Okay. So it's always better not to go for such. But if you're dealing with the plant tissue culture, then you can go for the organ culture. 1,000 times you can go. But in the case of animal tissue, you cannot kill the organism again and again to get the liver or kidney or skin, right? So it is not that ethical. But the advantage of using organ culture is that it is useful for studying the functional properties of cells, like production of hormones, and examining the effects of the external agents such as drugs or the other molecules and the products on the organs that are anatomically placed apart in vivo. Okay, so that was all about the organ culture. Now about the primary explant culture. So what do you mean by primary explant culture? So explant culture means you're going to take the small tissue or the fragment from the animal tissue. Okay, so only small portion has been taken. So the tissues adheres to the surface aided by the extracellular matrix like collagen and plasma cloth. Now this gives rise to cells migrating from the periphery of the explant. So what do you mean by this? Explant has been taken and the cells will start growing from here. So whatever tissue you have taken, small piece you have taken, right? And it is placed into the culture media. So your cells will start growing like this. And these migrating cells are known as the outgrowth. So these will be known as the outgrowth. Are you able to imagine? I don't think my diagram is so good, but I hope it is clear.
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
So you have got the culture dish like this, onto which you have got your explant, or it can be any small part of the tissue, right? Then what will happen? Slowly, all the cells will start growing from here at the periphery of the explant. Okay. Now these growing cells are called the outgrowth. Okay. Now the cell culture. So this is commonly used in labs. So this
something went wrong. Please try again.
Yeah. Hello. So this one is actually commonly used in the labs. One second. Yes. So in this case, what happens is like you get the, for example, you have got all these cells are there, and suppose your lab is not having, there's something called ATCC, American type culture collection is there. Okay. So in this, what you can do is you can just pay a certain amount of money and you can buy the cells. And once you buy the cells, you can actually keep it for long, for generations you can keep. Or if you don't want to buy, you can ask the other labs. Okay. So it is easy to get. And the media is also very easy to prepare. So most of the time, whatever studies, like for example, like how I am working in the cancer lab. So we use this method only, the cell culture method. So I work on the skin cells. So my topic was skin cancer. So I was using the skin cells. So since it was skin cancer, I was using HCT. So there are then HCT. So many other cells are there onto which I was also working. Okay. So now how you're going to get all these cells? So same way, once you got the cells. So now when you buy the cells, they actually give you either in the culture dish, if the distance traveled from that buying lab to your lab is less, then you can get into the petri dish. But if it is from country to country or state to state, then what you can do, you can actually freeze into the liquid nitrogen. Take the cells, put into the vial and add liquid nitrogen. So these freeze condition, you are going to transfer from one place to another place. Is it clear? So that the cells doesn't lose its property. Okay. Now there are three types of culture cells: precursor, differentiated, and stem cell. So precursor means undifferentiated cells, and it is committed to differentiate. What does it mean? Depending on the growth factors you are going to add into the media, you can actually make the cells to differentiate into skin, liver, kidney, or neuronal cells. Okay. Differentiated cell culture, it is completely differentiated. So, and it cannot further differentiate. It means what? It is actually either having the liver cells property or kidney cells property or brain cells property. Now you cannot change the activity or the function of these cells. Stem cell, as the name says, we know that they are the undifferentiated cells and they can go and become any type of the cells depending on the growth factors what you can provide. Okay. Now, the cells with a defined cell type and characteristics are selected from a culture by cloning or the other method. So that becomes the cell strain also. Okay. So, you know, monolayer culture. What do you mean by monolayer? So these terminology. Yes, it is the single layer. Okay, so onto the petri dish, you will have this single layer of your cells like this. And after this, it will stop dividing. That is called contact inhibition. Getting the point? Now what will happen, since the total surface area has been taken, covered up by the cells, So each cell is in contact with the other, right? There is no free space, and each cell is in contact with the other. And because of this contact, the further growth of these cells will stop. And that is called contact inhibition. In the case of cancer cells, this has been overcome. So they just keep on dividing. And what will happen in the case of cancer cells? They divide like this. They go on the top of each other. Okay, so this happens in the case of cancer cells. Whereas in the normal cells, they will just have only one layer of the growth, and after that, it stops. Now, monolayer culture is the anchorage dependent culture of usually one cell in thickness with a continuous layer of cells at the bottom of the culture vessel. Anchorage dependent means it needs the surface to attach. Now, if I say anchorage independent, it means it doesn't need the surface. It will be present as suspension, like how we have in the case of bacterial growth. Okay. Now, see, over here it is given the suspension culture. So some of the cells are non-adhesive. That is, they doesn't require any surface in order to get attached or adhere over there. Now, this is the suspension culture. You can see that the cells are actually floating in the liquid media. So these are the cells, and this floating on the liquid media. So one example I can give you, it is called THP1. It is for your macrophages. Okay. Now, if you grow, you can see so many cells are there now. Okay. So this is called 90% confluent. What is the terminology used? Confluent. Okay. Now, if suppose no space was seen and only cells are seen, then it is 100%. But in case of animal tissue, you should never reach the 100%. Why? Because it will start dying. So whenever it is 90% confluent, start doing the subculturing. So take small portion of this and add into the new media. Clear? Same in the case of your monolayer also. So once the layer has been complete, take small portion and add into the new media. Otherwise the cells will start dying. Now, primary culture itself, so we already mentioned that they are obtained from the tissues with the help of the enzymatic digestions, grown on the glass or plastic container. They are having the growth rate less and they are heterogeneous, right? Now, these are the just examples of primary culture. You can see the epithelium type. So you can see that the cells are having the polygonals in shape and they are flat and they are attached to the surface. So this is the beginning, and after that what you can see is entire space has been covered by the growth of the cells. Then you have got the epithelioid type, where it is having the round outline and they do not form the sheet like structures of the epithelia. Then fibroblast is there. So they are angular in shape and elongated to form the open network of cells. Can you see over here in the figure? The pointed ones are there, right? Can you see? So that is for the attachment. The fibroblast, they try to extend the network of the cells and then they start attaching with the nearby cells. Can you see these spikes over here?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, yeah. Then we have got the connective tissue type. So they are derived from the fibrous tissue, cartilage or bone. So all these different types of primary cultures we have. Now, what are the advantages and disadvantages of using the primary cell culture? So the first thing is that they represent the best experimental model. So instead of killing the animals, it is better to use these kinds of cells, right? Since they share the same karyotype as the parent and they express the characteristics that are not seen in the cultured cell. So it means what? If suppose I want to study from your this thing, like suppose I want to study from the Sandhya's liver. So I'll take a small portion of her liver and then start doing the experiment. So instead of doing and giving the experiment directly to her, it is better to put into the liver cells of her. And then I can see whether it is improving or not. If it is improving, it is good. Then I can give that drug to her directly, right? Instead of just checking on her. Now, the only problem is that the disadvantage of using primary cell culture is that they are difficult to obtain. Okay, as I mentioned, the more it looks easy that you grind the tissue, put into the media and culture it, it looks easy, but the difficulty is that it doesn't always go as it is planned. and it has got the limited lifespan. So by the time you actually start growing your primary cell culture, it has reached its maximum lifespan. And by the time, what will happen? It will die because it starts aging. So your experiment is not yet set up, and before that, the primary cell culture has been dead. So again, you have to start from the organ, taking the tissue, then again grinding. So this is the disadvantage of using the primary cell culture. So this already we have discussed about the anchorage and the dependent and the independent cells. So same thing is written over here. Okay. Then secondary cell culture. So how you get the secondary cell culture from your primary cell culture? So you keep on subculturing and resuspending into new media. That is your secondary cell culture. So whatever study you carry out, it is carried out in the secondary cell culture only. So when primary cell cultures are passage or subculture and grown for a longer period of time in the fresh media, it is called the secondary cultures, and they long last due to availability of fresh nutrients. So every day, after every 24 hours, you have to change the media. Okay, and that you can understand by the change in the pH. So from pink color, it will start becoming orange or yellow color. So from that, you can understand the nutrients are over from the media. You need to provide the new one. Okay. So the passaging is carried out with the help of the enzymes. So it is trypsin, as I mentioned. You wash it and then again resuspend into the new media. So now secondary cultures, they are preferred to grow and are readily available, useful in virological, immunological, and toxicological research. So this is very routinely done in the lab. So this anti-cancer test is also called MTT, MTT assay. Okay, so make short notes on MTT assay. I'll ask in the next class. Now, what are the advantages and the disadvantages? So this type of culture is useful for obtaining a large population of similar cells, and they grow indefinitely. Okay, the disadvantage is that they differentiate over a period of time. What does it mean? It means that you have started with one particular type of cells. You keep on culturing, what will happen eventually? It loses its property. And finally, if suppose this is the 10th division of the cell and this is your first. So if you compare your first cell and the 10th cell, they look different then. Even though you have started from first only, after repeated subculturing, the cells loses its property and it starts looking the new. So the 10th division and the first one, if you compare, it looks the different. Okay. So they differentiate over a period of time and then they generate aberrant cells. So these cells are no longer similar to their parent cells. Okay. Now the cell lines. So this also we have discussed the cell lines. You have got the finite cell lines and infinite cell lines. Okay, so they are grouped into two bases on the basis of the lifespan. So cell lines with a limited number of cell generations or growth rate are called the finite cell lines. So few examples are that is grown till 96 hours. So you can have the culture or cell cycle of 25 divisions and after that the cells will die. Okay, then indefinite cell lines, these are your immortal cell lines of the cancer. So all your cancer cell lines, wherever we do, they all are immortal. You can just keep on dividing them, change the media, always give them fresh media. What will happen? They just keep on dividing. Okay. The only problem is that they exhibit aneuploidy or heteroploidy. It means what? The chromosome number is not going to be same. Either it will be less or it will have more. Okay. Some problem will be there with the chromosomal number in these immortal cell lines. So one example is HeLa cell lines. Now, I need you to study about HeLa cell lines also. Why it is called HeLa? It is name of the girl on which first time it was found. It is because of the cervical carcinoma. Okay. So, you need to find out why it is called HeLa. What was her name and what problem she had. So, I have given you two assignments today. First, you have to talk about the MTT. Then, what is HeLa? Okay. Now, the human epithelial cells are there which are obtained from the cervical carcinoma. Now, these are made immortal with the help of the HPV virus. So, these cells will be infected with these virus and they become the immortal. Indefinite cell lines are there. It is easy to manipulate and maintain, and hence it also changes over a period of time. So commonly used cell line is over here is the CHO. It is also called Chinese hamster ovary. So every time, whenever, if you are entering any animal tissue lab, animal tissue culture lab, you are given CHO or HeLa. Okay. So you have to practice on these cell lines, and then only the other cell lines are given, which are difficult to handle. Okay. So they are very easy. Just provide the media. They just keep on dividing. Now, advantages of using continuous cell line. So continuous cell line means they will just keep on dividing. Okay. So you just provide the media and they just keep on dividing. Now, serum-free and protein-free media are used, and it may be available in the market. Now, this is very important, because if it is free of serum and the protein, it means what? These continuous cell lines need less requirement of nutrients. Whereas the other cell lines are there, you need to provide the serum. And without serum, they will not grow. Okay. So these cell lines can be grown in suspension as large-scale bioreactors. So just imagine, suppose any proteins or antibodies you need to produce, you can just culture them like how we culture the bacteria in tanks. So in the suspension culture, just provide the media, they will grow and finally harvest the animal cell lines, rupture their membrane and harvest the protein. So examples, you can study the intercellular activities like cell cycle differentiation, hormonal receptors are there. You can also study the cell adhesion and motility activity. So many actually applications are there. Now without animal tissue culture, it is difficult to bring any drug into the market. Okay. You can also carry out the cytotoxicity or mutagenesis test. So I'll give you one hint that MTT assay is related to your cytotoxic assay. So you need to get the full form and study. I'll just ask the questions. It's very simple actually. So in the next class, we'll discuss about the MTT also. You can also carry out the genetic analysis. That is, if any change is there in the chromosome or any change or any mutation is happening in the some of the genes, you can actually see there will be change in the shape of the cell or any function will not be happening. So such kind of studies can be done using the animal tissue culture. So finally, as the industrial level, you can also study, or you can also actually produce in large quantities, the plasminogen, interferons, blood clotting factors, hormones, antibodies, erythropoietin. So all these are now available in the market, which are required during the surgeries. Okay. So that was all about the today's lecture. And slowly, slowly we'll talk about the media, what kind of media are used. Okay. Then how cells are actually transformed, or how your animal cloning is done, transgenic animals are made. We'll talk about the dolly also, the first cloned animal, how it has been made, now how you can also do. So there are many things are there in the animal tissue culture. We'll also study like human cloning is possible or not. Even if it is possible, how it has been carried out. Okay. Yes. So thank you for listening. Any doubt?